Welcome to Respiratory. This is part one of Respiratory, and it's going to focus on the anatomy and physiology. The objectives for this section will be that the student will verbalize the structures of the respiratory system and their functions. The student will describe the mechanisms of ventilation, respiration, and oxygenation. The student will be able to obtain a health history and physical examination of the respiratory system. And the student will differentiate between upper airway disorders and lower airway disorders. The respiratory system is divided up into two tracts, the upper respiratory tract and the lower respiratory tract. The upper respiratory tract consists of the mouth, nose, sinuses, vocal cords, and the upper part of the trachea. The upper respiratory system warms and humidifies the air that we breathe in. The nose is going to filter that air, trying to catch as many viruses and bacteria and spores as possible before any of that gets into the lungs. The lower respiratory tract consists of the lower trachea, the lungs, and it does the work of gas exchange. The human body has two lungs with a total of five lobes. Together, these two tracts work with the circulatory system to oxygenate the blood, deliver oxygen to the body, and expel carbon dioxide from the body. The lungs are the main organs of respiration. The lungs are a stretchy organ that stretches and compresses with each breath, kind of like a balloon. Humans have two lungs, a right lung and a left lung, and the right lung has three lobes, an upper, middle, and lower lobe. The left lung has two lobes, an upper and a lower lobe. The area where that middle lobe would have been is taken up by the heart. The lungs take up the majority of our chest cavity, extending from the base of the diaphragm to the top of our chest, just above that first rib. The lungs are covered with a serous membrane called the pleura. There's another layer of pleura that lines the thoracic cavity as well, and there's a small amount of fluid, like a lubricant, that's between these two linings, and that is called the pleural space. The lungs are the main organs of respirations. The lungs are a stretchy organ that stretch and compress with each breath, kind of like a balloon. Humans have two lungs, a right and a left. The right lung has three lobes, the upper, middle, and lower lobe, and the left lung has two lobes, the upper and the lower. The area where that middle lobe would be on the left-hand side is being taken up by the heart. The lungs take up the majority of our chest cavity and extends from the base of our diaphragm all the way up to the top of our chest, just above that first rib. The lungs are covered with a serous membrane called the pleura. There's another layer of pleura that lines the thoracic cavity as well. And in between the lung pleura and the thoracic cavity pleura, there's a small amount of fluid, like a lubricant, that's in between these two linings. And we call that area the pleural space. Within the lungs, we have the bronchial tree, which is all the airways and passages the air travels to in the lungs. The bronchial tree starts with the trachea. It then divides to the right and left main stem bronchi. If you look at the picture on the left, you can see that the right main bronchus is a little shorter than the left. And this is really important to know, as many people who aspirate foreign bodies like dentures and teeth and food, it normally is going to go down that right main bronchus. From the main bronchus, the tree divides into the segmental bronchi and then to the subsegmental bronchi. By this point, the tree has split around 15 times. From here, the bronchi branch to become bronchioles, which then branch into their ends, which are called alveoli. The alveoli are small air sacs where the actual gas exchange occurs. And then within the alveoli, there's a chemical called surfactant, which reduces the surface tension between the walls of the alveoli, and it prevents them from collapsing. And if we didn't have surfactant, the alveoli would collapse every time we exhaled, and the walls would get stuck to each other, kind of like it was full of glue. The alveoli are where gas exchange occurs. The alveoli get oxygen from the air that we breathe in, and this process is called ventilation. Ventilation is the body's inhaling and exhaling, so breathing is also ventilation. When we ventilate, the diaphragm contracts and descends, so it goes down, lengthening the thoracic cavity. The external intercostal muscles, which are those muscles between our ribs, contract and they lift the ribs upward and outward. The sternum gets pushed forward, enlarging the chest from front to back. And all of this chest expansion increases the lung volume and decreases intrapulmonic pressure, kind of allowing air to move from an area of greater pressure outside the lungs to lesser pressure inside the lungs. So that pressure difference is causing the air to go in our mouth and down into our lungs. Once the muscles relax, the structures all go back to their original location, which is going to cause exhalation. When we talk about gas exchange for the lungs, we're talking about the capillaries releasing carbon dioxide into the alveoli, and then that carbon dioxide being exhaled out of the body, and any inhaled oxygen that's going into the alveoli is going to cross into the capillaries so it can be sent all over the body. This process occurs by diffusion. The alveoli have higher levels of oxygen than the capillaries, and the oxygen is going to cross that membrane into the capillary because it wants to go from higher concentration to lower concentration. And then independently of oxygen, carbon dioxide has a higher concentration in the capillaries than it does in the alveoli. So the carbon dioxide is going to cross the membrane from the capillaries into the alveoli, and then we're going to exhale it out of our body. And this process is called respiration. So ventilation is our like act of breathing, and respiration is the actual gas exchange. Then there's a third process called perfusion. Perfusion is the process by which the oxygenated capillary blood travels all around the body and goes to the body tissues. After the oxygen diffuses into the capillaries, it attaches itself to red blood cells. And most oxygen is carried by the red blood cells in the form of oxyhemoglobin. Hemoglobin also carries carbon dioxide in the form of carboxyhemoglobin. So hemoglobin doesn't only do oxygen, it does CO2 and oxygen. The pumping action from the heart pushes those red blood cells all over the body until they reach the capillaries in the tissues, and they diffuse the oxygen and carbon dioxide across those cell walls in our tissues. Then this process starts all over again. So the process of ventilation, respiration, and perfusion, all three of those together, is called oxygenation. So a lot of things have to go right for oxygenation to occur. So there's a lot of factors that can affect the process of oxygenation. Of course, the level of the health of the person is going to affect oxygenation. If someone is sick, especially with a cardiac or respiratory disorder, this process isn't going to function as well as it should. There are also many disorders for both of these that are going to affect oxygenation. And then let's think about the body. There is nothing that oxygenated blood doesn't touch. Any disorders that affects the blood's ability to get to the tissues is going to affect oxygenation. Then we have developmental considerations. Let's talk about elderly, as they are an important part of block one. Elderly have skeletal changes that can affect ventilation. Their spines can develop kyphosis, which contributes to an appearance of leaning forward, but also reduces the amount of motion that chest wall can have. In the lungs, the tissues and airways become more rigid, and they don't expand and contract as easily as they once did. The diaphragm moves less efficiency, and these two changes together make the lungs not expand as much, which doesn't allow as much air to travel throughout the bronchial tree to make its way to the alveoli. Older adults also have an increased risk for pulmonary diseases, especially pneumonia. Some medications can affect oxygenation, especially medications that are going to affect our cardiac function, like beta blockers and digoxin. There are also medications we can give to improve the body's ability to ventilate, like using inhalers for asthmatics. And there are some lifestyle considerations like smoking, aerobic exercise, occupational hazards, environmental hazards like pollution, that can all affect the lungs and their ability to oxygenate the body. And one thing I want you to remember about respiratory anatomy and physiology is that it is very dependent on the cardiac system. And the cardiac system is very dependent on the respiratory system. If the heart's not working well, the lungs aren't going to work well. And if the lungs aren't working well, the heart isn't going to work well. And this is the end of part one.